So we're at the last part of this symposium, and throughout the day, I wanted to invite all the panelists, the panelists of the roundtable to join us.
I wanted to first introduce our panelists for the roundtable. I think throughout this afternoon, we've heard the science, research, and action plans for addressing the issue of childhood obesity, but more broadly, thinking about how to create a healthy start and smart start. A lot of discussions and wisdoms came out from the audience questions. So I wanted to open up with a more casual discussion about this topic. So the first panelist is Kiyah Duffey. Dr. Duffey is the Director of Global Scientific Affairs with the LA Sutherland Group. But I know that she has a nutrition degree. And also, she's an adjunct faculty in the Department of Human Nutrition at Virginia Tech. Meanwhile, I've heard personal stories based on her parenting blog, which is an excellent blog, talking about her experience being a mother. So, very pleased to have you. Our second panelist is Christine Johnson Curtis. She is the Assistant Commissioner for the Bureau of Chronic Disease Prevention and Tobacco Control. So really at the forefront of the two biggest challenges in public health and tobacco control and obesity and nutrition. She also has an MBA. So really pleased to hear from you from the DOH point of view. We also have Tina Kauh from Robert Johnson Foundation. Tina's background is actually quite a data guru, data person as well, and she is leading the research evaluation and learning unit at Robert Johnson Foundation as a liaison for childhood obesity. So I wanted to start with Kiyah and just to hear your thoughts throughout this afternoon and your feedback on research actions and especially from Mon's perspective.
Of course, thank you. And thank you all for coming and to the organizers for inviting me and letting me speak on behalf of mothers and parents everywhere. It's quite a heavy task, I think, to have that role. I did have a few slides prepared, but I think I can say what I was going to show you, although it won't be quite as much fun. So I do have a degree in nutrition. The year after I graduated from college, I read a couple of books that really left a big impression on me. I read Marion Nestle's Food Politics, and I read Eric Schlosser's Fast Food Nation. And after reading these, I was both amazed and appalled at the state of the food systems in America, and I knew that I needed to do something to change that. And so I went back to graduate school, and I started using large, nationally representative, longitudinal data sets to really start to understand what people were eating, what these dietary patterns looked like, and how those affected and were related to health, specifically obesity and cardiometabolic disease. And I was plugging along in my research, and I was getting, you know, funding to do my research, and I was publishing, and these papers were picked up by the popular media, and then something happened to me, and I had a child, and then I had two more, and I have three at home who are six and under. And this suddenly put me having this entirely new perspective on my research, which is that being a parent and trying to follow these guidelines that I knew I should be following and that everyone else was telling me I should be following and that the research said I should be doing, it's really hard. It's really hard to do, even for me who has this education and you know, I sort of fit all of those criteria for someone who should be doing this well. But increasingly, you know, I face competing time demands, and my husband and I both work full time, and I have children who prefer various foods, and so trying to feed them in a healthy way is very challenging. Not the least of which is made more difficult because, as we've heard today, of the environment that we live in. But I think that there are some real opportunities, and we've discussed many of them today. And the two that I wanted to point out specifically. One was about pregnancy and using pregnancy as a time to sort of set the stage for some of these long-term behaviors. You know, I think a lot of the messages that women are given during pregnancy, it's about what we should be doing to make our pregnancy, to make us during our pregnancy healthier, and also to help to improve any outcome of the developing fetus, and sort of speaking about what happens right after the baby is born, during development and right after. And I think that women during pregnancy are primed to hear some other messages, some sort of long-term messages. And we're beginning to have evidence now about some of the impact, the long-term impact that health behaviors can have from pregnancy into infancy and even into childhood. So there are some studies recently that have come out that show that exposure, repeated exposure to flavors, even in utero, have this effect of children showing preference for those flavors once they start eating solid foods. And I think that there is real opportunity during that time to create some of these positive messages and use a time when women are ready to make positive behavior change and to really to jump on that. And the other thing, the other opportunity I see, which is very much related to the discussion that we were just having around early care and education, is for early care and education, daycare centers, preschools, to really start to focus, to shift away from some of these policies we have about what we should be doing, and specifically I'm talking around feeding our children, to thinking about why we're doing that. And creating some strategies about how we can do that. So as an example, I served as the director of nutrition at the preschool for my two youngest kids. And part of what I really wanted to do here was to create some policies that were reflective of longer term goals that we had for our kids and what kind of eaters we wanted them to be. And so, two specific examples. One would be that all of the kids in the preschool served themselves food when it was time to eat, and they all ate out of real cup, off real plates with child-sized silverware and cups. And I have a picture of my youngest, Alice, who at 9 months old was drinking out of a cup. There were no sippy cups, no bottles. With about a week worth of practicing with her and guiding her in how to do that, she was able to do it herself. And partly I did this because it was really important to me that my husband and I, and anybody who was providing care for our kids, did everything they could to not override those innate ability they had for hearing their hunger and satiety signals. And this was really important to me. The other thing that's really important for me with my kids is that they are willing tasters. So, full disclosure, I don't actually care right now with my kids if they, for example, eat 5 fruits and vegetables every day. For me, it's more important that they are willing to taste a new food, and that to me, this behavior is more indicative of sort of long-term success and ultimately establishing a healthy habit. And so in the preschool, we had taste tests a lot. I had a picture again of the kids with a citrus taste test, and they had various oranges, lemons, limes, grapefruits. And the goal here was just to get them to taste it. They didn't have to eat anything. And after tasting it, we would talk to them about what they tasted and give them tools and language to describe that. And again, the goal of this being that they are willing to engage in something that a lot of children find fearful, and that if we're thinking about why we do these things and have some of these long-term goals and have strategies for achieving those goals, that those behaviors we want, those what behaviors, will naturally follow. And I think, as Sally was just describing too, I think there's a lot of missed opportunity to engage parents and caregivers to sort of work towards those same goals, even to just have a conversation about what each of those participants' goals are.
Thank you. Christine? Great. So at the health department, we're really charged with thinking about the whole population, and in our case of New York City, and about disparities that we see in the population. And in particular, the health department is focused on three neighborhoods that we consider high risk and have high rates of chronic disease. That's the South Bronx, East and Central Harlem, and Central Brooklyn. And those are neighborhoods where we have health department offices, and a lot of our programming is focused on those. And so I want to describe a couple of programs that I think pull in elements of what we've heard today, and also about some potential areas of research. And this really lines up with what Gretchen described in terms of targeted education, and some of what was just Kiyah just described in terms of linking that parent and caregiver in terms of nutrition education, but then also talk about changing the context, because we still like to really do that at the health department, and I feel like we've been trying to do that on a lot of different fronts, and I think that's relevant to this much larger discussion about how do families and mothers go into pregnancy, childbearing, parenthood healthy, and what that means at the population level. So just two programs that are really targeted to high poverty neighborhoods and that the health department runs. One is something called Eat Well, Play Hard, and it's in childcare sites across the city. They do nutrition education for 6 weeks with kids in childcare sites, and a lot of kind of what Kiyah is describing, really getting kids to taste new fruits and vegetables. They also do nutrition education with caregivers and then also with the parents. So it's comprehensive in that it really tries to address all three facets. And I think what we've seen in an evaluation is that there are some positive results in the home. So more, an increase in vegetable snacking and an increase in consumption of low-fat dairy. What we don't have, and what I think for a lot of these nutrition education programs, is evidence of long-term impact. And we've talked a little bit about that today in the breastfeeding piece, and I think that's an area really to explore, is that when we're doing these intensive interventions, to see what happens years down the road, not just at the end of the six-week curriculum. But I think the more crucial piece is even is how to best reach the parents, because I think this comes up a lot, is that getting to the parents, I will say, in doing all of those classes, it's the parent classes that are the least well attended. And we know that's because parents have busy schedules, it's hard to get them in. And one of the things we've thought a lot about is how to better engage the caregivers about changing the whole culture of a childcare site, because they interact with the parents at orientation, at parent meetings. They sometimes hold ESL classes there. They have the opportunity to really change the culture. And in a lot of cases, the caregivers themselves, as a result of nutrition education, are making changes in their own lives. And that's really the start of that conversation. So I think that that pulls on a couple different themes that then lead into our next new initiative that I wanted to describe, because I think this is really gets at changing the environment and also starting to link early childcare sites with neighborhoods. And that, I think, gets at this feeling of layering being so important that Gretchen described, that we can't be just giving people nutrition education, but not changing the accessibility and affordability of fruits and vegetables in their location. And I want to say just a note on access to fruits and vegetables, because this comes up a lot. And I think fruits and vegetables are actually fairly accessible, at least in New York City, based on surveys, but not affordable. And so, you know, just making sure that they're there is not nearly enough. We have to change the financial incentives around being able to purchase them regularly and integrate them into people's diets. So what we have in, what we've done at the health department is something called a farm to preschool program. We just started it last year. It's exciting and we're still making changes to it and adjusting. It's essentially a community supported agriculture model, but it's just a weekly food box and it's about $12 per week. So you just buy, if you want to buy in. It's based in the child care sites where we're doing nutrition education already. And at the point of pickup, it's paired with nutrition education, which we think is really critical, which means that there's a recipe being made and you can taste the recipe from something that's available in the box that week. They accept SNAP. We distribute health bucks, which are $2 coupons for fruits and vegetables, and then also accept cash. So often people are paying with a mix to get to that $12. And they're also open to the community, which I think is incredibly important, because in a lot of cases, there was a church next door, there were people across the street, people are coming from nearby, and it actually makes fresh fruits and vegetables accessible, even if there maybe isn't a permanent retail location, at least on a weekly basis from July through November, there's a regular pickup site and it's not a season-long commitment. And so the participation rate at the community level was 50 to 90%. So a lot of times they're really supporting this box program. And what we're planning to do this year is make sure that the nutrition education for the kids matches each week. So if we're getting butternut squash in the box, the kids are learning about butternut squash and at least having a chance to even smell it, hold it, taste it, think about it. Because we want the kids to also drive the parent interest. And I think there's still a lot of potential with the program to continue to build that link between the caregivers, the kids, and the parents. But I think, you know, just thinking on nutrition education alone isn't always enough to change behavior. It really has to be paired with this financial incentive and the ease of having the pickup all at one place, someplace you're already going. And related to that, I will say our nutrition education always, for parents, always emphasizes how to enroll in SNAP. and how cost savings tips, because I think sometimes people think it's more expensive to use fruits and vegetables, and that we talk about seasonality and bulk purchasing and what's cheaper. And related to that, I'll just say in nutrition education, we have a program called Come See What's Cooking Kids, which is out at our farmers markets, only for kids and their caregivers. And again, this is just a real service to the community and is particularly popular where it's paired with WIC sites. So we heard a lot about WIC, and I think one of the pieces is making sure, again, that people can walk out of a WIC site, there's a farmer's market, there's nutrition education, and they get health bucks, and they can actually put into practice the things that they're hearing about. So I think those are ways we can do targeted education. They're really exciting. There's still a lot more research to be done. And to be honest, a lot of these things are relatively expensive, but I think they really pay off. And so we're excited about pairing a lot of different ways to change the culture around fruits and vegetables in particular. But the bigger piece is, I think, also changing the context, because I think one of the things that really came out of that first panel was it always is good for a woman and for a family to go into a pregnancy normal weight, and that's undeniably going to be beneficial. And the reality is that the majority of pregnancies in New York City are unplanned pregnancies. So women are not planning to get pregnant in a year, they're just pregnant. And so that means that women, but also men, because they influence what the family eats and how much people exercise, partners are incredibly important. The more everyone starts at a healthy weight, the better are going to be the outcomes and going to be better for kids mirroring the foods that are eaten in the home. That's incredibly important, that both all the adults that the kids see are eating a variety of foods. That's where they learn their behaviors. So I want to make a plug for, we certainly do a lot of media around sugar-sweetened beverages. We've done some around salt, some around fruits and vegetables. But I think there's more potential to do more targeted education to this early child care environment, early childhood, and pregnancy, and just people thinking about this being a moment in their lives to really think about health. But I think the larger context is always that we want all the New York City population to be healthy, and then we'll get some of these good outcomes down the road.
Thank you. Tina?
Hi, everyone. Well, my background is in human development and family studies, which brings a very multidisciplinary perspective on how individuals develop prenatally all the way through the lifespan into old age. And ironically, I'll say that although I spent several years getting a PhD in child development, I would say 99% of what I know about infancy and young children is I learned on the job as a mother of two kids, which I don't think any training will actually prepare you for in reality. So I'm a research evaluation and learning officer at the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. And so I want to kind of talk a little bit about bring the perspective of a funder and what our priorities are in the area of childhood obesity prevention, and given that I'm in a room full of researchers, also talk about what some of our research priorities are and where we see some of the gaps, particularly in the context of this infancy and early childhood and pregnancy developmental period. So some of you may have heard in February, we committed another $500 million towards childhood obesity prevention, and research is funding, evidence building continues to be a major component of that work. And we also announced that we have five new priority areas, which we're referring to as big bets. The first is making a healthy school environment, K through 12, the norm and not the exception across the country. And when I say healthy, I also want to clarify that we're not just talking about physical health, we're not just talking about childhood obesity, we're also talking about how to make the school environment socially and emotionally and physically healthy. How can schools act as a hub within communities for health, not just for the children who are attending those schools, but also for the families of those children and other community members. Another big bet is to make physical activity a part of the everyday experience for children and youth. How do we get kids engaged in sports and in physical activity in a non-competitive way? I'll say as a mom, one of the learning experiences for me has been that my kids are 4 and 6, and you realize that if they don't start soccer by the time they're 5, they're kind of screwed. They're not going to be able to play soccer once they're in 7th grade, because that's going to be too late. And so how do we get them to get involved, to be physically active in a way that's not going to rule them out from, that's not going to prevent them from becoming engaged in sports later on? The third big bet is making healthy foods and beverages the affordable, available, and desirable choice in all neighborhoods and communities. And Christy talked about the need for families to be able to have access, but not only to have access, but also to be able to afford those foods and also to make them want to consume those foods, let them know, educate them about how they can prepare those foods, that those foods can really be delicious. So the last two big bets that the foundation is focusing on are really focused on pregnancy and early childhood. One is ensuring that all children enter kindergarten at a healthy weight, which Claire mentioned in her opening remarks. And the last is very closely tied to that. It's kind of a sub-bullet of that, but eliminating the consumption of sugar-sweetened beverages among 0 to 5-year-olds. So again, speaking as from the perspective of a funder, I want to talk about where we see some of the research gaps and priority areas for in particular those last two big bets. We talked a lot today about childcare settings and childcare providers and where some of the policy levers might be within those settings. But we also should recognize that, especially when we're talking about the higher risk communities, lower income communities and lower income families, many of them are probably not using formal child care providers or going to formal child care settings. So really thinking about how can we make changes for informal child care providers? How can we influence the neighbors down the street who are taking care of 6 kids on that block because their parents are working? This also relating back to a comment that was made a little bit earlier during the Q&A of the second session, recognizing that physical activity is a critical component of the early childhood work. And understandably, among 0 to 2-year-olds, we're talking a lot more about nutrition. But even among 2 to 5-year-olds, it seems like the conversation is really focused still on nutrition and a little bit on physical activity. But we really need to build the evidence around where the policy levers are there as well, especially when kids get to before the age of 2, they're really starting to walk, develop physically. But by the age of 2, they're really starting to develop their gross motor skills, and it's an opportunity to gauge them in physical activity too. Another priority area for us is the intersection of obesity and hunger. Many of the kids who are at high risk for experiencing childhood obesity are also at high risk for being hungry, for not having access to enough foods. And so where are the opportunities there where we can kind of kill 2 birds with 1 stone? Another priority area for us is engaging the healthcare system and the healthcare providers. And I want to be clear, when I talk about healthcare, I'm not just talking about OBs and pediatricians, but I'm also talking about oral care providers, which is kind of a sector that we don't talk a lot about, but especially when you're talking about SSBs, it's a community that really cares about reducing consumption. And so how can we engage them in that conversation, in the actions that we're trying to put into place? And where are the leverage points within the healthcare system? Are there opportunities, for instance, within Medicaid, within the training of healthcare providers? Again, talking about OBs, pediatricians, and oral care providers, as well as a broader gamut, I'm sure, of other healthcare providers. And another area is industry. In addition to healthcare, we're focusing on how industry can be part of the solution as well. Sometimes it might require pushing them on changes that they don't necessarily want to make, recognizing that their bottom line is about their stakeholders, their shareholders, about making profit. But how can we kind of work together to make that happen and see them not only as adversaries in some instances, but also as allies too? And finally, our focus at the foundation is really on lower income, high risk communities, including ethnic minority families. And we're constantly thinking about how do we address cultural issues, cultural attitudes and beliefs at the policy level, at the environmental level. At the foundation, our focus is really on changing policy and the built environment. And so how can we do that in a way that addresses cultural beliefs and attitudes? And finally, when we talk about I'll just end with this note that when we talk about low-income communities, I think the default is often to think about low-income urban communities, but not to forget that there are lots of low-income rural communities that we should also integrate and be part of the solution as well.
Thank you very much. And I do invite the audience as well as the speakers to ask questions. But I wanted to start by reflecting a little bit on my own. So from my perspective throughout this afternoon, I was quite struck in the beginning. Andrew talked about don't blame the moms. And then Dr. Savitz talked about, you know, it's not about addressing gestational weight gain. It's the determinants of gestational weight gain. And the same theme about the drivers and determinants of breastfeeding practices also came out in Dr. Cullen's talk. So I think sitting here at the School of Public Health, and we're really characterized and proud of our sort of systems perspective in thinking about, it's not just about the problem, the issue that's on the banners that we talked about in this symposium, but it's something larger, and that has to be, here collectively, we're not just building evidence base, but we're also building a movement. In the Robert Johnson Foundation's language, it's the culture has to be changed to be a culture of health. So I think collectively, I'm just so pleased to hear this theme came out throughout the symposium, as well as from the roundtable panelists. So I wanted to hear about what struck you this afternoon the most, and whether or not you think that there is one area of action, you know, wearing the hat you're wearing, action or research that you think is the most critical. Christine, do you want to start, since you sit closest?
That's a great question. I will say that, I don't know if it's the most critical, but I think at the department, we're also particularly interested in this clinical environment piece. There's, I think, a lot of potential, and I agree with dentists on tobacco. It's the same issue, where there's a lot of potential for tobacco cessation counseling in the dental environment. And in fact, at a policy level, that's just changed at the state level in terms of reimbursement rates. And I think it's a good model for thinking about how can other clinical providers be engaged in kind of a new conversation. One of the things that's happened in New York City is there is more engagement around things like something called Fruit and Vegetable RX, which is distributing something like Health Bucks coupons at the in a clinical setting. In Boston, they have physicians writing prescriptions for bikes. You know, there are, I think, these new creative models, and I don't know anyone's really gotten to just the right one, but I think there's a way, and certainly the health department, I think, feels a responsibility to be talking to providers about lifestyle interventions, because really it's so much easier to prevent weight gain and start healthy behaviors for a lifetime, and clinicians in a lot of ways aren't really prepared to do that or trained to do that, mm-hmm. but there's a potential to really be talking to them about it.
So I can't resist but to ask that, because the conversation of implementing these programs and innovations is quite different from, you know, if you're addressing issues such as the taxes on sugary drinks and regulations, are there political challenges that you have to encounter at the city level, or whether or not we have communication challenges? I'm also looking to the other panelists for this.
I think I would just say for us, I think it's less political, but just that the clinical landscape's changing so quickly with the Affordable Care Act, and some of you who may be working in that environment, there's something called DSRIP that is affecting a lot of New York City hospitals that's really focusing more on chronic disease prevention. But I would say that the whole landscape is shifting so quickly, mm-hmm. people are still kind of trying to figure out mm-hmm. where their opportunities and what's mm-hmm. expected of them.
Thank you.
Sure.
Tina, go ahead.
So I would say one of the things that struck me early, especially during the first session, was how complicated that relationship between gestational weight and childhood obesity is. And I don't have an answer to this question, but I would love to hear others' answers to this or suggestions about it. But, you know, as I said, the foundation is really interested in policy level, environmental level, systems level changes. And understanding them where, trying to get an understanding of where the systems level levers are, where the opportunities are to target pregnant women but not in a way that, again, puts the onus on pregnant women. And so trying to get a sense of, you know, we want to target pregnant women, we know that there is this important association, but where are the opportunities there in that context?
It's difficult to pull out one thing, I think, but if I were to pick one thing I would like to see changed from the perspective of a mother would be our maternity leave policy. And I would love there to also be a requirement for a paternity leave policy.
Yeah. You just killed my question.
You know, personally, again, this is not just about the mom, right? This is, like, increasingly in our society, men are engaged and they're involved and they should be. And dads are incredibly important. Male role models are incredibly important and should be involved in all of these discussions. The other thing, just one parting thought, I suppose, I was really struck by something Andrew said at the very, very beginning, and I wrote down this note, something he was discussing about the averages and how, you know, children who are overweight or obese at age 5 remain so at age 50, and right, we kind of average out, right? We always create these smoothed curves, and when I was doing my own statistics, I think someone else mentioned this, like we find these outliers and we think, well, there's something funky about that person, I'm gonna just exclude them. Or, you know, they're outside the 3 standard deviation range, so they're considered an outlier. They might hold the key to something here. And I just had this thought that those are probably the really interesting cases, those people who are overweight or obese at age 5 and who are not at age 50. What did they do? What changed for them? And what can we learn from their experience?
Thank you. Moit?
Yes, that was... I'm not kidding when I said that, but that was precisely what I was going to ask about, because I was happy to see that we're discussing the policies of it. Because when you think about it, even in comparison across cities and across countries, across cultures, you look at, for example, the maternal leave policy in Germany, it's 1 year. It's 1 year, and it's considered bad form to come back to work before that. It's paid, of course, you know, so it changes the possibility of breastfeeding, obviously, and I wonder what impact that has into studies even within countries, in New York City, where it's really confounding some of the relationship that we're seeing in SES, because even if you want to breastfeed, but if you cannot bring the child with you to work, or you know, it's very different even in New York City, depending on the type of job that of work that the mother has, and the ability to have even childcare if one uses the pump. So I wonder what kind of impact that has, even to comparative studies beyond what we're actually defining and measuring. Mm-hmm. And I'm saying that before my CVD class asks their questions.
I think it's a really good point. You know, there are countries where if fathers don't take some leave as well, the entire family's parental leave is shortened, right? So fathers are expected to take part. And I want to make clear too, I don't think that everybody needs to take that time or that breastfeeding should be required, right? But everybody should have the option, as we said earlier. I think that having that choice. Personally, I cannot be a stay-at-home mom. I am a much better mother when I'm working, but I would have loved when my kids were little to have a chance to stay home for a longer period of time than I did. I had to go on short-term disability to take a full 3 months with my third child. I suppose maybe pregnancy and motherhood is a disability on some level, but to have to call it that, it's just really too bad. Mm-hmm.
Dean Free. Thank you all for a wonderful discussion, and all the other speakers as well. I'm interested in, maybe this is particularly for Tina and Christine, but Gretchen showed Frieden's pyramid. And really what the thinking that's going on could be summarized on is trying to piece apart the levers on a complex system and then figure out how to put them together across that pyramid in a, maybe a layering is the right word, but maybe it's also
understanding the critical levers that all have to be flipped to change an obesogenic environment and obesogenic practices. One of the things that's perplexed me is how to actually affect changes in concert across all of the levers of the pyramid, and where the responsibility and authority should lie for making that happen. And I'd be very interested in anybody in the audience commenting on that, because how to align changes when every single person in every single sector needs to take two steps in some direction together, how do you align those changes so that they happen and keep and be able to push in concert across that pyramid?
It's funny that the way you frame that is very consistent with the Robert Johnson Foundation's vision for a culture of health. One of the key, they're changing the word, the terminology all the time, but I would say one of the key tenets of that vision is that there's a shared value across sectors for health. And that multiple sectors will work together and collaborate more to make the changes that are necessary. I don't have an answer for your question, but I will say we are funding a study right now looking at, it's being conducted by ICF International, looking at bright spots around the country. So communities around the country, looking at four specifically, and New York City is one of them. Looking at four that have reported declines in childhood obesity over a certain period of time, and doing a deep dive in those communities to understand what policies, what strategies, what initiatives or campaigns were implemented in those communities around the time of those declines to better understand what potentially, you know, we can't make any kind of causal arguments, but to better understand what might be contributing, what might have contributed to those declines across a wide range of sectors. So hopefully results from that study, which will be out sometime next year, will help to inform your question.
Christine, and we'll take a last question.
So I think it's a terrific question, and I'd say it's probably takes up the most time at the health department in thinking through all the things we're doing and all the things we hear about other people doing and all the things we find out that we never knew that were happening, and then all the things that we realize maybe three people are doing and they didn't know about it. It's incredibly a complicated landscape, and there's so many players. I think I definitely don't have the answer, but I think there's maybe two ways to think about it. One is in this administration, but even historically, the health department has taken a place-based approach, and so thinking about it from this neighborhood level, and as I mentioned, these three neighborhoods we work intensively in, and having a health department office there, that's a way to start organizing and geographically bringing in all the community organizations, elected officials, other city agencies to the table. And it's incredibly important to have a physical office in those neighborhoods and a gathering place, so that in a lot of those places, essentially they do a lot of asset mapping, a lot of actually physically mapping, and then a lot of bringing in like Department of Transportation and parks and other city agencies, because it's very complicated to navigate all the different city agencies. That said, there's still a lot going on and it's hard to navigate. And so I think funders sometimes play an incredibly important role, because sometimes they come in with a specific goal and that is kind of becomes the organizing principle, and you bring a lot of people to the table that way. But then the third piece is really these incredible community organizations. Something, an organization like Make the Road in Queens that we work with as one of our grants, has a lot of the same services and incredible programs and reach that the health department does, but for a very specific neighborhood in Queens, and they're doing physical activity and nutrition education and community health workers and labor organizing and five other things and affordable housing. And so those organizations become kind of the organizing principle. So I think it happens in a lot of different ways in New York City, but there's still a lot of opportunity to be better coordinated.
Thank you. And
hi, everyone. Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts with us today. You know, the topic of your, I guess the title of your roundtable is Future Directions for Research and Action. And, you know, I really appreciate you taking the time to share your thoughts today, because from a student's perspective, this topic is the reason many of us are here today, why we came to school, you know, what we're passionate about helping to resolve in our nation or the globe going forward. So I guess given your experience in the field on a day-to-day basis for students here, what skill sets and coursework do you suggest we undertake during our time, the remaining time we have on campus, that you think would really inform our work, you know, as we take the next step into the professional field and really hope to make a difference in this topic, you know, kind of in the future going forward?
I guess that means I should say something. That is an excellent question. I generally think that for, depending on where you are as a student, but generally for students, the jobs that you will have are not yet created. And I think anything you can do to improve your critical thinking skills and your creative thinking skills and marry those with your passion, which is a very difficult thing to do. I realize I'm still working on how to do that well, but the more you can do that, I think those jobs will be jobs that you create. And then I can't necessarily tell you to take X class or Y class, but I think that those are the skills. We need people who are good communicators. We need people who can think outside the box, and we need people who can think creatively.
The only thing I would add or reiterate, because Kaya just mentioned it, was communication skills. Anything that's going to help you translate evidence into practice that will help you communicate with regular people, not just policymakers, I think is going to be huge for any work that you do.
Yeah, I'd echo that. I had this conversation with somebody recently at the health department. I think school sometimes allows a lot of longer papers and examinations of things. And one of the things we find at the health department, but also at other places, is being able to get across your point quickly in a concise way, and that's really appropriate for your audience, is incredibly important. And I think the other piece is understanding the political landscape, even in community organizations or the city or nationally. We're often working in a fairly complex political landscape that is maybe very far outside of traditional public health, but has to do with what the mayoral priorities are, what the governor's tax policy is, what the who's running the FDA, and those are all the things that ultimately affect what we can get done.
I'll say you should take my class, but and many others, and in fact, I think because this is a complex problem and requires many different solutions and many of them new and we don't know about. So I actually think that, you know, we're also learners as well as faculty, and going forward in the future, this is going to be a mutual learning process, just like the event today. So I want to thank everyone. I'm looking at the clock. Dean Free, do you want to say a few words to close the day for us?
Thank you.
I don't need to, but I want to. which is just to say this is, thank you to all of you. This has been a really important day from my point of view. Thank you, of course, to our conveners, Claire Wang and Andrew Rundle, and the host of people who worked with them to design this. Thank you to all of our speakers, but thank you to all of you, because complex systems require a complex effort to understand the problem, to understand the drivers, to figure out the layering and effective complex solutions. And it's events like this that bring us together to think together and learn together, which are critical to making huge progress. I've learned a lot today, so I thank everybody, and I look forward to us together, working on really impactful learning and solutions. Thank you all.
Thank you so much.